Hello, good afternoon. Today we are going to learn about the feed section on a draw frame. The feed section is known as a creel, and we shall first look at the what are the requirements of a creel, or rather how a creel what kind of creel do we require to process a very good sliver. The first point is that the creel must not introduce any kind of false draft. So it must basically avoid any kind of false draft. What is a false draft is, whatever draft you need to apply or whatever thinning out or attenuation we need to do, it is done in the drafting system of the draw frame, where we apply whatever amount of draft we need. But if in case there is an extra draft which is applied during the feeding of the sliver into the drafting system, because of some amount of tension that is applied during feed, then that must be avoided. So the creel must see to it that there is no false draft, that is unrequired draft, that is being applied during feeding of the sliver. Also, the creel must take care that whenever the sliver break occurs, the machine must stop. Otherwise, what you will get is an output sliver which is thinner than expected, because if one of the out of the 6 to 8 slivers that we are feeding, if one of them has broken, then the output sliver will accordingly become thinner than what is required. Also, the creel must allow easy, comfortable, and safe. All the three points are important. Whenever the sliver breaks, the operator working on that particular machine should be able to easily mend it. It should be comfortable for him to mend it. It should not be too high or too low according to his height. He should be able to stand comfortably and mend the break. And also, at the same time, it should be safe for him. He should not be harmed in any way. Therefore, a positively driven roller pair with sliver detection is provided. So this is the smart creel that is provided by Trutzler. Now we see the different kind of can arrangements that is available in a draw frame creel. First, we are going to see the draw frame creel for a single delivery, that means a draw frame with a single head, and how the cans are arranged behind in the feed area. So this is the first type where we are feeding 8 cans, and they are arranged in 2 rows for a single output can. So feed cans are arranged in 2 rows. Then in the second type, Ritter had invented this, or this could be another option of arrangement of the cans. It was done like this in a T form, where 4 are kept on one side and the other 4 on the other side. So you can see that in comparison to this, this is more, it requires less space lengthwise, although widthwise a little bit more space here. So this is known as T form. Then there's a third type where you can just put all the feed cans in one row. And these are the three ways of arranging the cans behind in the creel section, or the feed section of the draw frames. So can diameters range around 40 inches, which is around 1000 mm, and the slivers must run closely adjacent to each other as they run into the drafting system. As we are feeding 8 slivers here, they must not be fed too far away or separately. They should be quite close, so that whatever output we get a very neat web of slivers which we can condense and form the output sliver. So it should look something like it should be very close. It will be shown in the next diagram that will come up. So before that, before going on to that, let us see how the creel is arranged if in case it is a two-head draw frame. That means a draw frame with 2 deliveries. In that case, you will have 16 cans at the back, and they would one arrangement would be like this, which would be in a single row. And the other one would be like this, where there are 2 rows. You have reduced on the length of space that is required behind the draw frame. And the third one is similar to the Ritter's one, T form, but we here it is shown for two heads on the draw frame. So as we just said, the slivers must be running very closely adjacent to each other when they run in a drafting system. So the slivers, although you can make out that there are a number of slivers here, but they are too close and there is no space in between them. Next, we come to the topic of sliver guide. So there were conventional sliver guides before the drafting system, which would guide the sliver into the drafting area, and sometimes they would be wrongly adjusted. The most frequent fault would be they would be not really centrally guided, so it would be slightly offset sometime just because of the guiding system that was available. There is one patented sliver guide, and this kind of sliver guide, what you have is you can always have a consistent guidance system, and therefore a consistent sliver quality can be obtained. So this was invented by Ritter, and as you can see, this is a small guidance system which is there. It can simply be the guidance width can be changed just by rotating this particular piece here, and the web width therefore is reproducible and is set by simply swiveling of the guide elements. Additional fiber guides in the main drafting field can be provided, which prevent lateral slipping of the edge fibers. So to see that all the fibers are going into the drafting system in a guided manner, we can have another kind of fiber guide in the main drafting region as well. So because of this kind of guidance, fewer disturbing faults in the yarn are a positive result of this kind of sliver guide. Now we look at the top and bottom rollers. So this is a pic that is taken from the earlier video. So here we can see clearly when the cover is opened, you can see that the bottom rollers here and the top rollers. If you observe, the bottom rollers are made up of steel and the top rollers are covered with synthetic rubber known as COTS, 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 and this would be taken up at a later stage. Today's lecture, we will just see how the what kind of bottom rollers are there and what are its characteristics. So as we just mentioned, bottom rollers are made of steel and the top rollers are having a thick coating of synthetic rubber. The diameter of the bottom rollers can lie between 20 to 90 mm, but normally it is between 25 and 50 mm. So there are three types of bottom rollers that are there, A, B, C. The A is the axial flutes. That means if you can see the grooves on the roller surface, they are in the horizontal direction along the roller axis. The other one that we see is the inclined flutes, where you have the grooves at an angle to the axis of the roller. Then you have the third type, knurled. This basically provides a better grip on the aprons that would be running on it. So let us see each one of them. So the bottom rollers, as we said, are made up of steel and they are between 25 to 50 mm in diameter. They are fluted to improve their ability to carry the fibers forward and are positively driven. Bottom rollers on a drafting system would be positively driven, whereas the top rollers would be driven because of friction and because of the contact that the top roller will have on the bottom rollers whenever pressure is applied on the top roller. So we look at the difference between these two, A and B. Spiral flutes comparatively gives a quieter running without jerking, and it also gives a uniform clamping of the fibers. This is the observation when you change from the axial flute to the inclined flutes. Inclined or helical, or it is also called as spiral flutes, reduce drafting irregularity by shuffling the fibers in the delivered sliver. It has been found that the spiral flutes give a better regularity in the delivered sliver. So the B type of flute, that is inclined flutes, are preferred on the modern draw frames. we will see a little bit in detail on this, how it helps in shuffling the fibers in the next slide. But before that, let us see what are these knurls knurled fluting and where they are used. Knurled flutes are used on rollers receiving the aprons, as I just mentioned. And these apron system is there on speed frames as well as ring frames. This knurled flutings helps to hold the aprons or grip them, and they are able to receive it better than any other types of fluting. So, and it also helps in improve transfer of drive to the aprons. So this type of rollers, bottom rollers, you will find on speed frame or on ring frame drafting systems. So let us see why we said in the earlier slide that the spiral fluting using a spiral fluting gives you a better evenness or regularity in the output level. So the explanation is in this diagram here. When you look at the straight flute, this is a straight flute that is shown. And if there is a bunch of fibers that is approaching the one of the flute, the groove, and the land means actually the top part of the flute that is there, it is called as land. And suppose when this fibers approach this land, top land of the flute, if the fibers are already moving in bunches, what will happen is this particular flute will just transfer them ahead in the form of bunch itself. So let us see here. In case of straight flute, all the fiber ends falling on the land area is gripped by the land and withdrawn together as a bunch. So if in the previous process already there is a thick region due to some drafting fault in the previous process before this drafting, then what will happen is all the front ends of the fiber will form a bunch and will be withdrawn together as a bunch to the drafting system without any change. So the fault will remain, and that is what we're trying to say. Whereas in the case of spiral fluting, the bunching effect in the previous process will be broken. This happens because if you look at the spiral flute and suppose this bunch of same kind of fibers are approaching, you can easily see that the flute is not gripping them all at the same time. There is some time lag between this. You can see that this fiber has already reached the flute land, whereas this is yet to reach. So there is a time lag, and by the time this comes up to the flute land here, these fibers would have already moved ahead or moved on. So this is why we say that the spiral fluting is able to break the bunching effect. So the front ends of the fiber will be gripped at different times by the top land of the helical flute and therefore be accelerated sequentially rather than simultaneously. Here they would be accelerated simultaneously, whereas here you can see that the fibers would sequentially be allowed to move forward one by one, and that is why the bunching effect that otherwise would appear there are less chances that a bunching effect will appear here. So if in case there is a fault that is there in the previous due to the previous process, that would it will become less prominent here, and what you get is a much more regular sliver as compared to the straight fluting that that could provide. So this is all for today, and thank you very much.